Jørgen Rasmussen. Thank
you. Yeah. Close enough. Close enough.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Before we start, how many people here have read my book, Provocative Hypnosis? Just so I have, that's a pretty huge group. Okay, cool. So for those of you who have and for those who haven't, my story is basically that I entered the world of NLP and hypnosis back in 1998. And since then, I've made a full-time living seeing clients and being somewhat experimental. You know that thing you often learn in various fields about scope of practice? You know, you're qualified to do A, B, and C? I was more the type of guy to go, you know, screw the scope of practice. Let's work as far outside of the scope of practice from day one just to see what I can do. So I would read the Bandler books and the Grinder books and the Ericksonian books and think to myself, you know, let's just assume that all of this is possible and can I do it? So I would, and this is a way to start out for those of you who want to, for those of you who might want to start seeing clients but aren't quite sure how to do it, start either a full-time or part-time impossibles practice. What I would do, I would put these big ads in the paper that were pretty cheesy. Just say phobias, no change, no pay. And if you have very little skill, it's a very effective way to get clients. I was often broke. I did a lot of free work for a long period of time, which has gotten better over the years. During these 12 years that I've spent in the trenches, I've discovered a few things that I would like to share with you to make your game better, you know, both within yourself and also with the clients that you might see. So if anybody has any questions around it as we proceed, please feel free to ask. I'm very, very approachable. Let's pretend that this is exactly 1 year ago. Exactly 1 year ago, I got a phone call from a former client who had just been brutally attacked and attempted raped. So what had happened to this client is that she'd been walking home from a party. This was in Oslo. She was not drunk. She'd had a couple of glasses of wine, you know, some influence, but nowhere near drunk. And she lived in an apartment complex where you had to walk through some bushes and a garden and stuff to get in. And once she got in, there was some guy there waiting for her, and he gave her this predatory look and basically jumped her and proceeded to beat the crap out of her and pulled her pants down and was about to do what rapists do until the neighbor came out and he took off and he ran. So a couple of days after this, she calls me and she's in a mess. Her symptoms are wild mood swings, intense fear, insomnia, and what clients will very often do, which I will invite you to pay attention to, is that they will often lean on certain phrases as they describe their problem. In her case, she leaned on, "I just froze." This was a sentence that she repeated probably 5 times during our telephone interview. "I just froze." So this was a sentence that was specifically marked out. She was also kind of bummed out about, she had some traditional martial arts training and you know, she just froze and didn't fight back, which was really hurting her pride in a way. If you got this call, A, what would you do to help? And B, what would you want to know? Here's what I pick up, and I have asked this question to a couple of groups, and the common denominator for all the people I asked this question is that they all seem to think that this is something to be done in the office, using some sort of eyes closed or eyes open, imagery, hypnotic, psychological, whatever technique. Listen to her metaphor, the thing that she leaned on. "I just froze." She repeated it several times. That little piece there, what I'm always looking for when I speak to a client is, if they're on the phone, where does their voice change? Where do they mark out some sentence or some metaphor or some word? Because that's really golden for me. So what I'm looking to do is to unfreeze the experience. She just told me what to do. So what I did is I used to run a self-defense club, and we have these suits. where you get a plexiglass helmet, you get some foam stuff here and there. And I would ask her detailed questions about, you know, what did the rapist say? From where did he approach you spatially? How does it look like in the garden? And I found a place in Kongsberg that was close enough. And I had her come, and I told her, you know, bring your training gear, your training tracksuit on. And I got one of my friends and self-defense students to play the attacker. So I had her take on the gear, and she was a bit like, you know, this is a bit silly because this is a simulation, it's fake and everything. But as we entered the garden and the rapist, you know, jumped out with his predatory look, she went right back into the state and she froze again. And I'd force her to fight through it. We redid the simulation again and again and again and again. She even puked. Her whole body responded. It was a full body experience. And we probably did the scene 6 or 7 times. And after that, she had a dramatic change. You know, she was sleeping again. Mood swings were pretty much off because we unfroze the experience. If you were there, you would have seen that she's lying on the ground and she's freezing. By coaching her, by getting her to move her hand into a claw, to kick with her leg, to get her body to actually move through the frozen experience is really what she was looking for. She told me. So when I came back home from trainer's training in California, how many people have been to California before? Well, you can imagine some of the characters at many of these NLP events, the kind of new age spirituality feelings, types. And when I did trainer training, there were 80 people in the room. And I noticed that every single demo worked. Every single demo worked. Worked every time. And I came home and I was almost evangelical in terms of, this stuff is so great. It's awesome. I'm going to start seeing clients. And the city I live in is a place called Kongsberg, which consists mainly of farmers and very left-brain engineers. He's nodding his head. He's from Kongsberg too, and it's very different from California. It's kind of a different mindset. And what I would notice is that what I noticed after a while was that the people who were selected as demo subjects on most of the NLP courses I went to had 4 things in common. They were generally really good at visualizing, you know, making imagery in their mind. They were usually pretty emotional or affect oriented, meaning that they could easily get in touch with their feelings, you know, using their imagination. Very responsive. They had good so-called VK synesthesias to talk NLP, meaning that they picture something and their body responds strongly. And they were good hypnotic subjects, good at going into that focused, uncritical state. What I noticed is that the teachers would usually scan for these types of subjects, and they're usually pretty easy to spot. And if you get those up on stage, it's usually pretty easy to do change work. My problem was that when I came home, from time to time, I would encounter these left-brainers who were just anal, to use a word. I mean, riddled with internal dialogue, very little access to feelings, very skeptical, very jaded. And that kind of inspired me to take my work outside of the office. Because I truly think that, you know, hypnosis is very, very useful and powerful. And I also think that you as a change artist, everything you do in hypnosis, you better be able to do outside of hypnosis as well. You better have live interventions or at least the choices of doing that. One thing that was very useful too in terms of running the impossible to practice is that from time to time I would get people who had no money. Not the types who said, you know, I want a new tattoo, so I don't want to buy you and I'm pretty cheap, but the people who genuinely had no money. And I'd make a deal with them and say that, okay, I'll work with you if you will volunteer to be an actor, one of my actors. So if I need you to play a drug addict, or if I need you to play a prostitute or whatever it might be, you'll step up and do your part. Either an actor or a model for a modeling project. And if you do an impossibles practice, it's relatively easy to get a little support team that you can use in that way. Let me ask you something else. Who here has a martial arts background? I know there's a couple of people. Could you please come up here? What's the problem with all self-defense training? There's many problems with self-defense training, but one of the main problems is the word defense. You see, if I'm, just load up the shot slowly. If I'm a boxer and I practice slipping the punch, that would be a boxer's move, right? If I practice some sort of other martial art, you don't have to do it again, I might do some sort of other block, right? If you look at martial arts, people will say, how do you defend against the kick? How do you get out of the headlock? How do you block or slip or evade a punch? If that's all you ever do, then you're training yourself to wait until the guy actually punches you before you do something. That's the frame you've bought into. That's the frame. Look at this. So, give an example. For me to slip his punch, for me to block his punch, for me to duck under and shoot in for a tackle, I still have to wait until he punches before I do something. If I'm going to defend against the headlock, if that's all I do, then I have to practice him putting me into the headlock and then getting out of the headlock. So I'm training myself to wait. Now, what usually happens, I'm going to relate this to change work in a bit, but what usually happens before people actually throw the punch? See, here's the thing. When he loads up the punch, and the punch is about here, this is where the punch is the most dangerous. This is where people train themselves to wait until the punch is at its most dangerous before they move. In my model of the world, that's kind of stupid. But you know, there you go. I mean, you should do that because sometimes you won't be able to detect it. But this is where the punch is at its most dangerous. So if you divide this into positive energy and negative energy, when his hand is moving forward, like, let's just stand like this. So what happens before people punch usually? Well, they have a tendency to do that. They have a tendency to shift their feet like this. This is a very common one. They have a tendency very often to, I used to work as a bouncer for a while, so they have a tendency to look down. They break eye contact usually just before they throw the punch. They have a tendency to shift their feet. Here's where the punch is starting, actually, right? Their dialogue will have a tendency to either get turned off, or they just start saying, you know, single words like, so, yeah, okay, that type of thing. That's a red flag. So my point is, when you see this, when you see so, yeah, that, when you see that stuff, the punch has already started. This is where you should make your move. This is where you should train yourself to move now, because when, just do those things.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. That's, now he's in negative energy, meaning that he's loading up the punch. Right now is where he's at his most vulnerable. So this is negative, 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 negative. He's going to raise it up. He's going to go negative, negative, depending on how much he loads that thing up. And now you go positive, positive, danger, 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 danger. Train in martial arts. Wait until this point to move. Positive, 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 negative, 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 negative. Right? So when he moves, I want to move first. That's one thing. So one thing I noticed when training my students was that the word defense, the whole frame defense, conditions people to wait until whatever attack there is in positive energy before they actually move. So I got this from a guy called Tony Blauer, to give credit where credit is due, but he calls it protective offense. So I noticed when I trained people that as soon as they got that frame, protective offense, they would start responding off the small cues. So we're going to assume here that I've done everything I can to detect this situation. I've done everything I can to verbally diffuse it. It's not working. I can see that the pre-contact cues are increasing despite my verbal efforts to kind of slow this down. So if I see enough of those cues, and I see, yeah, so here's what I want to move. I want to train myself so that as soon as he, you know, do your cues again, boom, here I want to be on them. Because now he's at his most vulnerable. He's in negative energy in a way, right? So I'm doing protective offense. Here's another thing, too, and I'll relate it back to change work in a minute. Let's assume that he's unarmed, like he has no weapons. What's the most dangerous attack that he could deliver? See it? His head, yeah. The headbutt is going to be pretty dangerous from here. Why? Because it's a linear attack, and it's very close. So the chances of him hitting me with it are going to be pretty good. Which others? Knee strike.
Knee strike.
Yeah, you can. People usually have a lot of shakes in their legs though, and it's kind of hard to pull it off in reality. But yeah, you can.
Elbow strike.
Yeah, the dangerous attacks from here are going to be anything that's linear. The straight punch. The headbutt, the knee again, the choke from the inside, the uppercut, all the stuff that you can't really see. So what I've trained my students to do is that I've trained them to adopt what we call a nonviolent posture, like this. Because this is the position that I can actually talk from. I can verbally diffuse from here and do my best, right? What else does this do? Yeah, it's put me very close to his throat and his eyes to attack. The other thing it does is that it primes him in such a way that if he's going to attack, and this is an unconscious thing, if he's going to attack, that he's going to come around. If his hands are up like this and he's kind of talking me down, first of all, even if I'm a bully, you know, I'm no longer going to view him that much as a threat because it looks like, you know, he's kind of passive. So my adrenaline goes a bit down. I might start fantasizing about who I'll brag to this to after the fight. I'm no longer in the fight. I'm underestimating the guy. The chances of me, if he's like here talking, the chances of me trying to punch straight or do the headbutt or do the inside choke, I could still do it, but it's less likely because it's in the way. So what he's doing now is that he's seducing me to come around with my haymaker or my tackle. I've influenced him beforehand in terms of how he's going to attack if he does. Please, 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 please have a seat. So here's what I've noticed. In the first 8 years that I did my change work, I called myself a therapist. I called myself a psychotherapist. I called myself a hypnotist. I've found that the word therapy, for me, you can experiment with this, has not been a very useful frame. So when somebody uses the word therapy, what are the words that tend to be triggered in terms of that way of understanding things? You'll very often trigger stuff like cure, patient, therapy, something's broken, you know, something's wrong to be fixed, chemical imbalance, medication, disease, an expert in terms of me being the therapist, the victim of some horrendous disease who pretty much can't help it. And I found that this was massively destructive in my work. Relate this to the protective offense stuff. I realized that by using terms like therapy, I was firing off all the wrong associations, all the wrong primes in terms of how people would present their issues and how they would respond. So if you had asked me the question, how do you define hypnosis, or how do you define what you do, I usually define myself as a state trainer. That sounds weird in the UK, probably. But I do it because nobody else does it. And I do it because people, the word trainer presupposes that you're a participant. You're active. You have a lot of resources. You're going to be doing tasks. You're going to be doing experiments. We're going to evaluate your performance. My job is not to cure you or to save you or to do anything. My job is to kind of, you know, teach you, instruct you, guide you, mentor you, whatever it might be. And I've found that by calling myself a trainer, I tend to prime or elicit more of the almost athletic mindset of people having a goal, people being active participants, people being accountable, being responsible. I'm no longer a savior. Any participant in a sport realizes that he's got to do the work himself. His trainer can only coach him. And this might sound like, you know, something unimpressive or really small or really insignificant. Experiment with it. I promise you, this little thing has been huge for me. Sometimes I'll call myself a trainer. Sometimes I'll be an instructor. Sometimes I'll be a hypnotist, especially with smokers. But I have different definitions and different roles based upon what responses do I want to elicit in this particular client. When I work with clients internationally sometimes, I'll say I'm an insultant. I piss people off and get paid for it. It's a pretty good frame. So what I would recommend that you do is that I have a friend called Ross Jeffries. He's a seduction guru. He's got a very valid point in terms of marketing. He says, get to know your client's fears, frustrations, and failures, the three Fs. Like, get some good insight knowledge of the three Fs, your client's fears, failures, and frustrations. And then, based upon those, create some sort of role relationship, some sort of frame, some sort of metaphor that creates a relationship between you where you can most efficiently elicit whatever responses you want to. So I'll give an example. Let's say somebody comes into my office with a so-called, they talk about an identity crisis, right? If they do, I'll often use the Gilligan frame. I'll say that trance is the phase where people are kind of stuck between two identities. They're leaving one identity and they're kind of moving into a new one, but they haven't quite done it yet. And a lot of various symptoms and emotions and stuff appear in that process. Hypnosis is kind of a ritual to help people make that passage. If somebody comes in and they say they have an identity crisis, then that's a very cool way of framing hypnosis. If I get somebody who's very analytical and very skeptical in a way and very detached, for example, in Norway, people will very often do cognitive behavioral therapy. So I know that a huge percentage of the clients that I see will have been to some sort of cognitive therapist. Now, obviously, since they call me, it hasn't been entirely successful. It's a good bet. So if somebody comes in for some sort of fear or anger problem or whatever, I'll usually say something along the lines of this. I'll say, you've been to cognitive behavior therapy, PACE, right? Building a yes set. You've learned about distorted thinking patterns, PACE, building a yes set. You know how you can think differently. You've been practicing how to dispute your distorted thinking patterns. All this is a PACE. And despite knowing all this stuff intellectually, you can't quite feel it yet in your body. They go, oh, that's exactly it. So say, hypnosis is a process that you can use to take those understandings you have intellectually and create a felt experience in your body. Oh, I'll sign up. So I have, for all the different, call it, types of clients and different types of symptoms that I work with, I've really been interviewing people looking for the three F's. What are the common fears and frustrations and failures of this particular group? How can I speak their language and frame hypnosis as the missing piece? If you do that, people get really responsive really fast. Really responsive really fast. I have something of a different take. I'm a pretty simple guy. I view the work I do pretty much as this. When somebody comes into my office, they're usually overly identified with some self-concept, some identity, or some role in relationship to other people. You could call it a pattern. So when they come in, they're usually overly identified with some self-concept, some identity, and some pattern in relationship to other people, right? My job is to do the opposite of what they're expecting. Let's take a quick look at language, how language works. When you use language and you use concepts, you're creating artificial boundaries that don't really exist in experience. So we're imposing categories like good, bad, right, wrong. These dualities, if you will. And what usually happens is that people take one part of the duality and they say, this is me. So I want to be, for example, more confident, more certain, and I want to be more certain of myself, for example. My job is to kind of activate the not self and hold it for them, the uncertainty, the vulnerability, the other side of the coin. The concept of being certain makes no sense if you can't have uncertainty on the other side of the coin. There are two parts of the same coin. So let me give you a few examples. My best way of getting people more responsive or getting people into hypnotic states is pretty much to break their pattern. So one of the first clients I saw back in 1998 was one of these CEO hotshots. I was 21 years old at the time. He could have been my father. And on the phone, he was very much identified with being the CEO. He was the boss, right? Hardworking, had a temper problem, ends in anxiety. And he talked a lot about the importance of time. Time is money. My time is valuable. Don't let me sit in the waiting room. You know, I got stuff to do. And the importance of punctuality. So he was kind of overly identified with that. I got a hunch pretty quickly that this guy's probably going to be pretty late for my appointments. And predictably enough, he was. So I'd already made the sign, you know, our appointment was for 2 o'clock, have gone fishing, call me when you're serious. And I put it up at the door, and I didn't go fishing, I went into the bushes to wait and spy and see. And I could see him approach the door, and he was like cussing and swearing and all of that stuff. But when he called me later, we had excellent rapport. I was like, now we can play. He's testing me. In a way. When somebody comes in to my office, I use a technique I call role projection, meaning that I'll look to project some sort of role onto them that I think would be the most useful to elicit whatever response we're looking for. So for example, one thing I often get with the left brainers is, I'm skeptical. I'm a skeptic. I have this critical mindset, and they kind of lean back and they're looking. So what I will usually do, and this is a gold mine of information if you use it, if somebody comes into my office and they lean back and they say, I'm a real skeptic, you know, I don't believe, blah, 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 I'll kind of roll my eyes and I'll go, my God, please tell me that you are, because I haven't had a real skeptic in my office for over 2 years. Please tell me you're real. And they'll usually throw the person off a bit because nobody responds like that. And he'll lean forward a little, and I'll usually say, look, most of the people who come into my office and claim that they're skeptical have bought into the official frames 100%. Whatever the media or the experts have told them, they believe uncritically. And now they're looking for everything that doesn't quite fit with that frame. Now, that's not skepticism. That's obedience. A real skeptic is, of course, going to be skeptical towards me, but he's going to be just as skeptical to his own assumptions that he brings into the office. And he'll realize that the only way to be a real skeptic is to have the experience first 100%. So are you fake or are you a real skeptic? And everyone, with the exception of one client, has said, oh yeah, I'm a real skeptic. And you can see their physiology change. They're looking, kind of looking forward. I had one client once who said, well, that's just your definition. Just one. The reason I like this particular piece is that I'm defining being a skeptic as someone who, yeah, of course is skeptical towards new experiences, but he's smart enough to realize that, you know, I'm bringing my own assumptions into the table as well, and the only way I can really know is by having the experience 100%. You can deliver this kind of embedded command as you do so. And as soon as they say yes to that, they have bought into the frame that they're going to have the experience first and then evaluate. That's what hypnosis is about, anyways.
What do they get to know about hypnosis?
The people who claim to be skeptical are usually sheeple. You know, if you ask them, you know, have you done this? Have you read some books? Do you have some knowledge of language, neurology? They'll say no. And they always have the same objections. I mean, it's very seldom that they come in and they actually present, you know, an interesting objection or an interesting way. You know, I've been thinking about this. What about this, this, and this? It doesn't happen. You'll get the usual, you know, will I lose control? Will I be asleep? You know, the common stuff that people who don't know anything will believe. And those are usually the people who would credit themselves with being skeptics. So that's a really, really important piece. Another thing that I will do with the left brainers, the ones who are really kind of skeptical and critical, and they're afraid of losing control, is that I will frame the problem they have as a trance. So let's say that they're scared of flying. So I'll tell them, you know, when you're at the airport and you think about going into the plane, you know, you're actually at the airport, nothing's happening, but you're mentally, you know, getting so absorbed into the fantasy of a horrible trip or the plane crashing or whatever it might be, that your body reacts as if it's true. That's actually a trance state. So I'll frame their problem as a trance, and I'll tell them, you know, afterwards, when you look back at it, you know that it's irrational. But once you're in it, you know, you're thinking the same thoughts, you're feeling the same feelings, you're doing the same type of stuff, it's really hard to get out of it. Hypnosis is really just a little ritual where you can go into a state where you're not that controlled by your normal way of thinking, feeling, and perceiving, and that gives you the opportunity to create some more options. It's a very, very good pace. So I'd really like to inspire you to take a kind of eclectic view and look at the different types of clients you work with, find their three Fs, their fears, failures, and frustrations, and ask yourself, you know, what type of relationship, what type of frames, what type of metaphors can I use to most efficiently elicit whatever you want to elicit in this person? And define what you do, and define hypnosis based upon that. If you do that, people will often get very, very receptive. Now, I've noticed something else. When I came home from California, there were two clients that would bug me the most, that would be the most tough to work with. One would be kind of like the analytical left-brainer, who would be very detached, a lot of internal dialogue, not that good access to feelings, you know. None of the NLP patterns would work. It was really, really tough. The other category would be the extremely highly hypnotizable clients. They'd sometimes pose some interesting challenges as well. So I'd like to do a little demo, which I think you will find a bit interesting. My friend, would you be willing to demonstrate a deep trance phenomenon for me? Cool. Do you remember the state you were in here when you did the stuff with James? Okay. If you were to stand up and just notice that for each step that you walk towards here, deeper that trance becomes. That's right. Even closer. That's right. There you go. Even closer. Even closer. That's right. Even closer. There you go. All the way in. Very, very deep. And I'd like you to turn towards here, that spot there, and just lift your arm a little bit up here. Now, I have a question for you. I want you to focus very, very intensely on this. You're standing there. My question for you is, what breed, color, and size does that dog there have? Take a look there, right there, right there, right there. What breed, color, and size does that dog there have? As you see that now clearly. What type of dog is that? Yeah. And how big is it, approximately? Quite big, yeah. And notice what it's like when I snap my fingers and that dog becomes twice as big now. Look at that. Take a look at that. And you take a look at his eyes. Now, as I touch you on the shoulder, the dog will disappear. Boom. Close your eyes. Close your eyes. And I'd like you to go twice as deep. Because the next time you open your eyes, you're only going to be able to see right through me. I will have disappeared. You will not see through me. You will just see right through me when you next open your eyes. In the same way that you walk past people and you've kind of seen them, but you haven't seen them. You look for those card keys and they're there, but they're not really there. So when I tell you to open your eyes, I'll be invisible. Open your eyes now. You can hear my voice. What can you see now? When I snap my fingers, you'll just see my head. Now, hey, dude, what happened to my body? You can see my head. What happened to my body? Close your eyes. Go twice as deep. And the next time you open your eyes, these suggestions will be canceled, and you'll enter into your normal waking state. Now, open your eyes. Thank you. Please keep standing there. Now, I want to give some credit to James. I've never endorsed a hypnosis product before. He has a product called Hypnosis Without Trance. I think it's really, really good. And I think it's a testament to his type of theory. If you look at what I did right now, there was really no... You asked for anchors earlier. This was a demonstration of anchoring. I talked about left brain people. I was constantly standing over here. When I talked about the highly hypnotizables, I was standing here. It's a spatial anchor. I know that James elicited some hypnotic phenomena with him over here. So I want to move him to the same spot. If I move him to the same spot and I fire off whatever anchor, he's going to be in the same. Here's something really interesting I want you to take a look at. My friend here would be what you would call a highly hypnotizable. They're great. And there are some challenges I want you to look out for when you work with them, because there are some pitfalls. 10 minutes, okay, cool. I want you to notice something. How many of you could kind of watch him and see that he was highly hypnotizable? How many of you? There's, if you hypnotize enough people, you'll be able to spot it. I never do hypnotizability testing with people. I never do it. I agree with these guys in terms of I'm just going to congruently go in there and do it. However, sometimes I do fail. Sometimes I don't get the responses. And the book I wrote, Provocative Hypnosis, is really about, you know, what do you do when you've been congruent and you've done the stuff and you're still not getting the responses? There's a couple of things you can kind of spot in the highly hypnotizable ones. One thing you can look for, and I'd invite you to do this, hypnotize people and elicit deep trance phenomena, and then have them do an eye roll. It's a pretty good predictor. Now, take a look at this. Can everybody see his eyes? Okay. So what I'd like you to do, I'd like you to just keep your head still, and without moving your head, just turn your eyes as if you're looking up through your head, as high as you can. That's right. And as you keep your eyes up there, just close those eyelids as you keep the eyes up. There you go. And open your eyes again all the way up. That's right. Okay, good. Now, did you notice that? Did you notice how much of the whites that kind of became visible? And you could see that his eyes almost rolled back into his head. For those of you who do the Day of Element induction, where you have people open and close their eyes several times, it's a really good one because you can really kind of like see the eye roll. It has a tendency to kind of trigger that. Marcus, would you please come down here too? And Steve, could I borrow you as well?
Yes, sir.
Is there anyone here who have had some troubles with hypnosis who haven't quite responded to it? Yeah, you. Okay, cool. I'm gonna make a very simple little point here. Okay, so what I want all you guys to do, as well as you can, is to actually use your imagination as powerfully as you can. Now, please put your hands up like this. Okay, close your eyes and keep them closed, and just turn your right wrist upwards. There you go. That's right. And in that right wrist, I want you to imagine that I'm putting a really heavy book. And as you see that book, you can begin to feel the heaviness in that hand. As you see that book, you can begin to feel the heaviness in that hand. That's right. There you go. There you go. That's right. And on the other hand, I'd like you to imagine that there's 200 balloons pulling that wrist lighter and lighter, higher and higher, up in the air. That's right. And the more you can feel that left hand lifting all by itself floating, the more you can begin to feel the heaviness in that right hand. That's right. Now, open your eyes and take a look at the arms. Okay, please put them down. What can you read out of this? I did the same, you know, imagination exercise with all of them. I congruently. What can you read out of it? I'm not saying that this is, you know, a perfect induction and that this will kind of help you predict, but it's a pretty good predictor of how accessible hypnosis will be for them. Yeah, you can do confusion inductions, you can do various tricks, you can work on the barriers. But I think if you're working in private practice and you need to have something happen quickly, you better adapt the interventions to the hypnotic capacities of the client. And if I get responses like this guy and Anthony, I'll usually spend a lot of time with having them do symptom prescriptions, ordeals, work in the real life to kind of complement the hypnosis. Because I want to make it kind of emotional. Did how many people here could kind of predict that they would respond the way they would? After a while, you'll kind of learn how to spot it. So take a look at something else. Do the eye roll thing again. Just as far up as you can. And as you press them up, just closely, slow, closely, there you go. And all the way up again, all the way up. That's right. So that's a pretty high eye roll. Anthony, sir, would you please do the same for me? That's right, as far as you can. And as you keep them up, just slowly close those eyelids. And slowly open them again. See the difference? Now, Marcus, would you do this for me? Just all the way up. That's right, there you go. And as you press them up, just slowly close and all the way up again, all the way up, all the way up. Good? You can see he's going in. It's a wonderful induction. Whatever the eye roll does, it kind of taps into that hypnotic capacity. Now, Steve, all the way up, all the way up, and slowly close those eyelids down. Slowly close them down and look all the way up again. That's right. So here's the thing. He has a very high eye roll. This guy had something of a low eye roll. This one had a pretty good one. And this one too had a pretty good one, which in my book is how I determine whether I will kind of force the hypnosis or not, usually. This is just based upon a lot of experience. If somebody has a pretty high eye roll and they still kind of can't go into a hypnotic state, then they have a tendency to have the capacity. And I'll use shock, I'll use confusion, I'll do different stuff to get the response. This is not an exact science, but at least for 6 months, I would hypnotize people, elicit phenomena, and then afterwards, to not fuck things up, I would test their eye rolls. And I found that there was a huge correlation between their trance talent and the flexibility of their eye roll. In most cases, not always, but in most cases. There's a guy called Herbert Spiegel who discovered this, who wrote about it in Trance and Treatment. He's done thousands of cases where he's done this. So if you have a client and you're kind of looking at, does the person seem to have the talent and capacity and there's some sort of psychological block, or does the person quite simply not seem to have the talent for it? An eye roll is usually a pretty good predictor. It's a pretty good predictor. So thank you, guys. The kind of pitfall sometimes with the highly hypnotizable clients is that they're often so willing and so ready to step into uncritically a new reality that it can look really impressive sometimes in the office, but then you kind of realize that people around them are hypnotists too and giving them suggestions. And you really want to spend a lot of time future pacing them and training them for meeting the skeptics in their lives. I'll give you one example. I worked with a teenager called Richard who was 16 years old, and I would do allergy work with him. He had a super high eye roll, could do all hypnotic phenomena. He was wonderful. And he would, you know, leave my office, we would test for pollen and foods, and he'd be totally, totally fine. And he'd go home, and you know, his mother would call me and say, the allergies are back. And Richard would come back in, and his uncle would drive him and say, well, I think the problem's back. And I would ask Richard, like, dude, are you allergic? He said, well, I don't know. Well, do you still respond to it? I mean, I always use a doubting voice tone. Do you still respond to it? How do you know? Well, my mother tells me. We do the work again. Everything's seemingly good. You go home, same story again. So I brought him into my office and I said, Richard, how big is that Christmas tree right there? And you could see his pupils, and he hallucinated the Christmas tree in my office in June. And it was totally real to him, as real as that stuff. So I spoke to the mother, and I discovered that his mother had a very commanding, like, voice tone. And she would ask him, Richard, can you feel the allergies? And he would respond by producing them. So I had to train the mother to leave him alone and to change her voice tone. That's one of the pitfalls of the highly hypnotizable ones.
With all the war in Afghanistan and things like that around the world, obviously I've got an interest in military personnel from a military background.
Yes.
And we have a lot of people coming back with post-traumatic stress disorder, one thing or another.
Yes. Already there, you've shot yourself in the foot. I've worked a lot with people with so-called traumatic, post-traumatic stress disorder. I never accept the frame. So that's the first thing I would do. I would say, specifically, how is this a problem for you? What are you experiencing? And really non-medicalizing. There's no reason to use medical terminology in describing those types of responses. There's no brain pathology, there's no... So just blowing that whole frame out and kind of eliciting what are his or her symptoms, and then asking, okay, how can I present what I do to elicit something that will help this person through? People will be very specific with you. Like the really cool thing about the highly hypnotizable ones is that you could pretty much suggest any hypnotic phenomenon. They'll do it on cue. So for example, with insomniacs, if you want to use that terminology, I've had several people come in and they say, you know, I can't sleep. I'll say, you know, I'm really good at sleeping. I actually am. I'll sleep for 10 hours often. I say, how do you do this? And I say, you know, I'm lying in bed and I'm kind of remembering all the other nights I haven't been able to sleep, and I start stressing. I tell myself I got to sleep, I got to relax, blah, 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 blah. What's this person telling you to do? What hypnotic phenomena could you elicit, which if you did, would blow the whole thing out?
Amnesia.
I've done this with so many people with smoking challenges who are highly hypnotizable. You just hypnotize them and tell them that whenever you put your head on the pillow and you're not having sex, you will have amnesia forever having had a problem sleeping. And once they accept that, you know, the problem has a tendency to be blown out. But the person has just told you.
Well, the spokes, I didn't get the actual answer that he asked you about post-traumatic stress.
Okay, so what I usually do with them is that I'll usually do a quick, rapid induction, usually a hand drop induction for those who are familiar with it. And I'll suggest that you have an emotion inside that has everything to do with, and then I'll list the symptoms that they have described, and I'll amp the emotion up. And that emotion might be deep fear, it might be sadness, it might be anger. I'm not suggesting which emotion it should be, I'm just saying you have an emotion inside that. And once they feel that really strongly, I'll usually do an affect bridge suggestion, saying that, you know, I want you to follow that feeling back to the very first initial specific memory that the feeling is connected to. And then I'll help them update the memories. Here's one thing I've found with people with PTSD, and that is that the people who, two people go to Iraq. They both see or experience some horrible stuff. One person comes back and is functional, and the other person comes back and he's, you know, a nutcase. The person who comes back and is riddled with symptoms will usually have some earlier trauma in their background that the traumatic event will kind of attach itself to. So by helping them, you know, reconstruct memories that are even earlier back in time to kind of like get the initial stuff has a tendency to work really well. That's been my preference in doing that type of work. Yeah, one last story. I had a client come in. I used to work with the unemployed people. It was a highly hypnotizable one too. And he, brilliant guy, had tons of ideas, had a practical business plan. He said, I just can't do it. Just can't get myself to do it. And I was like, how do you know that you can't do it? Well, I get this feeling in my body. Therefore, it's real. Just told me what to do. That was the entire thing there. So what I did, since he was so easy to hypnotize, I hypnotized him and I had him, I can't quite remember what I had him hallucinate, but I had him hallucinate lots of wild stuff. And I was like, does this feel real to you? He was like, yes. And then I made myself disappear and I had some tears in the room disappear, and that felt real to him too. And then I had him open his eyes and I said, look, if you can see things that aren't really there and that feels real to you, and you cannot see things that actually are there and that feels real to you, how real, with this doubting Tonelli, how real were those limitations you thought you had just because you used to feel something? And he was like, that was it, blew it out. So his trance words, his description told me that this is the hypnotic phenomena that's missing. So you could ask yourself with clients, what's the hypnotic phenomena that if I either took it away or elicited it would kind of blow this whole thing out? So I think my time is up,
yep.
But you've been a great audience, and thank you very much.